religious women are the Carmelites of the Divine Heart of Jesus. These Carmelites work in the world and live in a cloister. They work with the young, the old, and the homeless. Their order is 100 years old, both inside and outside of the church. The Carmelites of the Divine Heart of Jesus are known as Women of Compassion. This is their story, a story beginning in the dark days of the late 19th century in Central Europe and unfolding across continents and oceans to the threshold of the 21st century. From a small orphanage in Berlin, these women of compassion now carry out the church's mission of caring for suffering mankind on three continents. The head of this order of Carmelites is Mother Mary Catherine of the Immaculate Heart of Mary. She speaks in her native German about the goals of the order.
Our congregation is based really on the gospel, and the gospel is always relevant at all times.
Mother Mary Catherine is the Mother General, and she visits her sisters in all the countries in which they work. Here, she's with her American superiors in Milwaukee.
Women of compassion for the suffering of mankind, healing wherever healing is needed.
Father Kramer is a member of the Priests of the Sacred Heart Order and a never-failing source of rich spiritual inspiration for the Carmelites of the Divine Heart of Jesus.
The compassion that Christ had for the poor, for those who were without leaders, and that would be continued now through members of the mystical body.
The Carmelite Sisters of the Divine Heart of Jesus now number well over 500, and they work in more than 50 homes, daycare centers, treatment centers, and convents. They're located in 8 European countries, Canada, the United States, Nicaragua, Venezuela, and Brazil. This is the International Mother House of the Carmelites DCJ in Sittard, Holland, some 62 miles from the city of Cologne, West Germany. It's a busy place, coordinating and caring for the spiritual and temporal needs of all of the Carmelite sisters and their widespread apostolates. The Mother House is also home for Mother General Mary Catherine, members of the congregation's General Council, and dozens of sisters. Mother Catherine is convinced that the Carmelites offer something very important for our times.
Care for the young, for the aged. But nowadays, perhaps the need is even greater. So many have turned away from God, do not relate to God, many will not hear of God. And it is our mission to try by our lives and by our service to witness to the love of God and to bring people to Him.
People seem to flock to Sittard for special occasions, for retreats, seminars, research, and just meditation and visiting. In this special event, diocesan officials and townspeople joined the sisters as workmen carried out a dramatic installation of a renovated statue of Our Lady on top of the Mother House. Sittard and nearly every one of the Carmelite DCJ convents and homes around the world have spacious grounds and peaceful settings to aid the sisters in their prayerful life, meditation, and well-being.
We are blessed, I know we are, with wonderful sisters.
Sister Andrea heads the central province of the Carmelites DCJs in the United States. The province was created in 1964.
Today we have 4 homes for the elderly and 1 child development center here at St. Agnes Home.
The provincial mother house is also at St. Agnes Home in Kirkwood, a suburb of St. Louis, Missouri.
We are preparing the children and the youth to live a good, wholesome life, to prepare them for their life to come. And the elderly, we are preparing them for eternal life.
Sister Immaculata is the superior of the northern province of the Carmelites DCJ in the United States. Originally, the northern province, with its mother house in suburban Milwaukee, was the order's only province in the U.S., comprising the entire country. Today,
we have seven homes. We have one, two, three homes for children, treatment centers, and then we have four nursing homes.
The southwestern province now covers the most territory, from Southern California and Texas into Central and South America.
We have four homes in Texas, one in California, La Mesa, two in Nicaragua, and one in Venezuela.
Sister Angela Therese heads the southwestern province, and she's been a Carmelite for 30 years.
We have the two ends of the rainbow, the young ones and the old ones. The little ones, we prepare them for life. Right, we teach them all about God, and they're so anxious to learn about God. Those little ones, and then the people, we prepare them to meet God, whom they have learned to know and love. So we have two ends of the rainbow, the little ones and the older ones. So I think it's a beautiful life.
The Carmelites created a Canadian province in 1950, and its superior is Sister Anne.
We have four houses. We have one in Medicine Hat, Alberta. There's six sisters there. We have eight sisters in St. Catharines, and eight in Toronto, and eight in Mississauga.
Sister Anne and the other Canadian Carmelites are proud of the fact that their home for children in Toronto cares for 154 youngsters, and it's an ethnic melting pot.
We represent about 20 nationalities, but 75% Portuguese, the rest are all mixed. Every nationality. East Asian, we've got Europeans, few Canadians, not many.
Regardless of what country they work in, the sisters are not just babysitters in the daycare centers they operate.
Nuns are mothers rather than sisters.
These religious women find themselves assuming the role of mothers in many daycare centers the Carmelites operate in Europe and in the Western Hemisphere. Their spiritual director sums it up.
To create a family spirit, boys and girls, as they are in a natural family, small children up to 16, 18, as a normal family would be. And the sisters and the mother in that family.
In San Antonio, the sisters care for some 80 children at the Martin Luther King Center. And the administrator says the religious background of the children doesn't matter.
Now, most of them are non-Catholic Baptist, most of them being almost the black part of the...
At lunch, the little ones pray before and after they eat, and they remember their prayers.
I love working with them. They're so tiny, and yeah, so are their mothers when their mothers aren't here. So I love it.
It's not all sweetness in life. Accidents do happen with the little ones, and the sisters get into the dirty details while dispensing tender, loving care.
It's a lot of work. But there's a lot of love, and it's a privilege working with them. So it's not really work. It's all a privilege, this whole, our whole life.
And for these nuns, working in the inner city of San Antonio is a real calling.
Yeah, it is, and especially for our black community, because a black male is such an endangered species school-wise. And so we strive to give them what they need those first 5 years so that it's... kind of a part of them, so that it gives them courage to go the whole 12 years.
Not all the sisters at the Martin Luther King Center are young. One of them has been a Carmelite for 65 years.
Since I entered the convent, I first helped in the kitchen, and then they put me with the children. And I stay with the children many, many years.
To the children at the center, the sisters are all the same, regardless of age.
It doesn't matter who the sister is. Sister can come from another home, another province, and to them it's sister. They all flock to them and run to them. It does make an impression.
Here in Kirkwood, Missouri, the sisters have been encouraged by a little experiment they've been conducting. Because the St. Agnes Home for the Elderly and the Carmelite Children's Center are located on the same grounds, the sisters have been bringing the young and old together at times. Regularly and during the holidays, the children from the Child Development Center bring music and joy to the lives of the elderly. For many of the youngsters, it's their only contact with elderly people. On special occasions, such as Carmelite feast days, the youngsters join with the sisters and some of the elderly at the St. Agnes Home in entertainment programs. Some of the more active guests at St. Agnes Home for the Elderly visit the daycare center and volunteer on projects. Center director Sister Mary Benedicta is happy with the volunteers, and 85-year-old Margaret Hassler loves the whole thing.
Well, I think I'm helping. I'm helping here. If I didn't do it, somebody else would have to, and so I might as well do it and get something out of it for myself.
Mixing the young and old benefits both groups. The children get some wise supervision and nurturing, and the old folks get some lively moments and sparkle in their lives. This mixing has been going on for 5 years in Kirkwood, and the Carmelites say it's a success.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine.
Music is a big part of the Carmelite program at all of their homes for young and old alike. In Corpus Christi, Texas, the tots at the Learning Center join in with the guitars in classroom work.
A lot of their learning activities are done through music, whether it's learning the religion. We do the religion stories through music, or learning their numbers or colors, their ABCs. Everything's done through music.
But the Spanish songs and music seem to ignite the little ones, as well as the sisters, most of whom have Latin backgrounds.
I've learned a lot from the children. You know, they're so simple and so loving, and they're so willing to learn, and so are we too. We're learning all the time, you know. We're always learning.
Many are neglected in more ways than one, not only in by not having the one parent, by some are just not clean, not properly fed. Some come to us with very poor diets. And here we're able to give them a home for the homeless, like our Mother Found just wanted.
Surprisingly, the Carmelites in Canada find themselves handling more and more Latin children in their bustling day nursery in Toronto.
Well, you just happen to be in the Latin section. This used to be Little Italy. When I first came here 30 years ago, 75% were Italian. Now 75% are Portuguese. Maybe in 10 more years it'll be 75% Chinese. The Chinese community is moving into this section of the city.
Sister Agnes and her staff care for 154 children ranging in age from 2.5 years to 9 years. 40 are preschoolers and the rest are school-aged kids who stay at the center before and after school and get lunch there as well.
Little chickadees sitting in the tree. Michelle flew away and then there was three.
This work has been going on now for 100 years. But how did this all start? And who was the foundress of this religious community, these women of compassion? Her religious name was Mother Mary Teresa of St. Joseph, and she was a native of Germany. Unusual as it may seem, she was Lutheran in her upbringing, and she became a Catholic, a contemplative, a pioneer, and a social activist of the 19th century. Mother Mary Teresa's family name was Anna Maria Tauscher. Her father was Pastor Hermann Tauscher Vandenbosch, a superintendent or bishop of his district. She was born in 1855, one of eight children. Her mother was her idol. From her, Anna Maria developed an early love for the poor and needy. And there were plenty of poor and needy in those days as the Industrial Revolution swept across Europe. Maria's mother took an active part in urban mission work, and her daughter joined her in the work. By nature, she was a bashful child, but she excelled in school and loved to read, especially the scriptures. Her mother died when she was 19, and she was left to run the parsonage for her father.